Hi guys, I'm here with Lior, known as Riker, in the NXT community, and he just gave a really good presentation of NXT, and it's the first time I meet him too. I met Kushti last year, who was also a core developer or working around the core. But Lior here really is working very deeply into the core together with Jean-Luc to realize stuff, and I'm very happy to meet him and to ask some questions, mostly from an investment perspective, me as an investor, to get a little bit more confidence in my investment, as NXT has dropped a lot in value, so I certainly can use some reassuring words how great NXT is. So let's start with that. How great is NXT, Lior?
Comparing to other blockchains, I just lectured before about how to choose the blockchain on which to develop your next application. And together with the audience, we reached the conclusion that NXT is probably the best solution for many applications.
Yes. So currently we see that Ethereum is valued extremely high, 500 million. It was valued 30 million since the start of in its IPO. Then it was traded the Ether, and it went to 60 million. I thought it was overvalued since the start, but now it's valued 500 million. So a lot of people think that that Ethereum has really the edge here and is able to attract a lot more developers to its platform to build decentralized applications. How do you see that if you compare it with the one that's really in the spotlights today and is being valued very highly?
So first of all, I think that Ethereum has very interesting technology with a lot of potential. NXT, I don't think it's a zero-sum game, that one blockchain takes the money from other blockchains. We are just in the beginning. There is a room for everybody. I think the guys in Ethereum still hasn't proven themselves with real applications under real business demands and conditions. And they definitely haven't solved scaling and blockchain bloat issues that we are currently working on, or at least designing a solution for. Regarding NXT, first of all, never take investment ideas from a Java developer.
Okay.
And I really don't know, you know, all the value of all the cryptocurrencies is complete speculation. It's like lottery right now. Okay, I suggest that you check the fundamentals.
Yes.
Okay, is there good technology? Is there good community? Are the developers persistent? Can they be trusted? That's how you should look at it. Looking at the daily price is meaningless. I mean, unless you need to sell tomorrow, and always never invest your last money in crypto anyway. So
yeah,
I hope you didn't.
Well, I did invest my future into it, a lot will depend on the success of it for me.
Okay.
But what I also find very interesting is to talk a little bit more about the lead developer Jean-Luc, because I never had personal contact with him, but you are working closely with him. So I assume you have a lot of personal communication with him, is that right?
Yes, I have to admit that I don't know Jean-Luc in person. We, of course, exchange a lot of emails, chat, and everything. And I must say that even though I don't know him personally, I think he is a very trustworthy individual. I think NXT wouldn't be where it is now without him, and I mean not the market value, I mean the feature set, stability, And I think that he is definitely the man that I expect him to take us forward and to lead this development in the coming years. Mm-hmm. And I really hope we can continue to work together.
Yeah, because some people may not know, but with NXT, the lead developer Jean-Luc is fully private, anonymous, so his real world identity is not known, just like it was the case for Bitcoin with Satoshi.
Yeah.
Before that, he had come from Beyond, who was a lead developer in NXT. His identity is known, but only after a while, but he left now. And Jean-Luc took it over as lead developer.
I think on this subject, I think the anonymity, I think Jean-Luc has good reasons for staying anonymous. I hope that in the future we will be able to reveal himself. And I think that for the day-to-day operation of NXT, this fact is completely irrelevant.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that with respect to his identity, we can always review his commits. The source code is open source. Anyone can review it for backdoors. I think that while it may be an inconvenience that Jean-Luc is anonymous, I don't think it's a big problem right now.
Yes. Well, for me neither. I think it's a feature, a great feature of NXT.
Yeah. It makes it more mysterious.
Yeah, but also more secure, because people forget that there is some real world risk here in developing a valuable cryptocurrency. There was a good reason why Satoshi was anonymous. It would have been probably a world of hell for him today if he were known. But because some early developers of Bitcoin have had some really big problems with people blackmailing them, government agencies invading their houses, things like that. So I think care is important. How do you look at that? Do you think there is like a risk to be like to have your real identity connected to like the core development of a cryptocurrency?
You see me here, so
yes.
So I guess I'm willing to take the risk. No,
yeah.
I think you watched maybe too many movies. No?
That's possible. Yes.
I don't know. I hope not.
Yes.
I hope there is no big risk. But
yes,
you see me here, so
yes. Well, the example I was giving, I forgot his name. Anyways, it's not very important. But yeah, it's very interesting. I had another question, but I forgot it. Is there something you would like to say to people that are following NXT as a cryptocurrency, possibly or also invest in it, and have seen a lot of losses? For example, how do you look at the recent proposal of Jean-Luc to split up NXT into two cryptocurrencies, FNXT and NXT? Do you think this is required to scale up NXT, or do you think other solutions could be better?
I think that as a blockchain protocol, we shouldn't let NXT stagnate. We have to understand that we are at the beginning, okay? We can't say right now everything is done, we are not going to change anything. That's not going to happen. Of course, and I promise you, we are going to make changes. We are going to make a lot of changes. We will do our best to maintain backward compatibility. We will do our best to document everything. But it's not realistic to expect that at this stage we will completely freeze the development of NXT and not continue to develop the protocol. Regarding the NXT 2.0 plan, this plan is, at least I'm discussing it with Jean-Luc for at least 6 months now. I must admit that when he first presented it, I also said, well, and FNXT, yeah. Okay, but I think that what's good about this plan is that it's solving a real world problem that no other blockchain has solved so far, which is a blockchain globe. Because think about it, every dividend payment of 0.03 NXT, every encrypted messages that you send, any vote that you make, everything is stored on the blockchain and is stored there forever, and it serves absolutely no purpose after the message has been read or you received your payment. So if you want to scale to global levels, I mean, if you want to stay with a network that processes 2 transactions per minute, 10 transactions per minute, then we are good to go. But if you want to scale to global scales, this way of storing all the history all the time is not going to scale. That's any napkin calculation will immediately prove this. So we are solving here a very real problem. Now, you can question if we should solve it now or first do another feature. Okay, that's legitimate. You can suggest alternative plans, and people suggested very interesting plans, but right now, every suggestion that I saw had some problems with it that does not seem to affect the current NXT 2.0 design. I think that while during implementation, we are going to run into issues that perhaps we do not foresee it, and we'll need to adjust. We need to adjust many times. But what I see recently with the discussions that people try to predict what would be asset values a year from now in place where you can predict what would be an asset value 2 hours from now, that's ridiculous, and it's not a good argument, and you cannot base design decisions on such claims.
Yes, the claim being that a lot of asset issuers, some of them think that with splitting FNXT into 2 coins, FNXT and NXT, that the value of NXT will drop, and so the value of their assets quoted in NXT will drop too. And so they use this argument to say that it's a bad idea and that they should leave NXT with their assets. I agree with you. This is highly questionable, but it's understandable. People make these have these fears. It's the same as me. When the past 2 years NXT has gone down in value, and long I thought that maybe it's because a lot of people that invest in NXT, what they do is they actually start very quickly selling their NXT and then they buy assets with it. And so I was thinking, yeah, so NXT value is going down because people are not investing in NXT coin, they invest in the assets, and so they sell NXT coin, they don't value NXT coin, they only value the assets, and indeed the assets were going up in NXT value for quite some time, and in huge percentage gains. So, but actually when I think more about it today, I realize that actually no, a lot of people came to NXT because there was an asset exchange, and so it did attract a lot of people that also invest in just the NXT coin. It just made the market bigger. Do you know what I mean?
I think that it's right now, the value of NXT is going to fluctuate because of speculators, because of factors we won't be able to predict or understand. And you cannot base the design decisions of the blockchain about things that you have absolutely no control about.
Yes.
Okay, we need to stay at the front end of the blockchain industry, call it that. We need to have all the basic building blocks, and I think we are doing good in this respect, because I think that feature by feature we are comparing pretty good with other blockchains. But we need to continue. We need to continue to move forward. And hopefully if we work right, the value will come. The value will come from things that we cannot forecast today. Mm-hmm. It will be absolute, I assure you that it's absolutely unpredictable. And the reason, if the value increases, we probably won't know why, and even when it decreases, we probably, we of course we will always blame someone when it decreases.
Yes, yes.
And when it increases, it will always, we will always take credit.
Oh, of course, that's our doing, eh? We did that.
but this is completely random, and we have no control about why. What, I mean, you can worry about it because you put a lot of money there.
I do. But I also celebrate when things go good.
Right, but don't put, so I suggest, don't put your last money in NXT. Okay, 1%, fine. If you are brave, 10%, I mean, your euros won't be worth much next year anyway. So.
Yeah. Well, I currently have 35% invested in NXT, and I'm pretty sure not many people go that far. Or do you?
35%?
Yes.
Yeah. At least you have a Lamborghini already. So.
I still have something to liquidate. I certainly stopped driving it with the current valuations of my investments. Yeah. But it's very interesting. What do you think of the past year? Like, Boss and Dave said of the NXT Foundation and the license of the NXT software has changed into a GPL license today. And then the business strategy seems to be of Buzz and Dave, together probably with Jean-Luc and possibly you too, that NXT should find, it would be good for NXT to find businesses that also pay the core development, and at the same time the core developers can then also continue to develop NXT, but while also getting paid. Is that the strategy being followed today?
I don't know. Do you think that people should develop NXT and promote it without getting paid?
No, but what I'm wondering is maybe because we have a saying in Dutch that says wiens brood men eet, diens woord men spreekt. The one that feeds you the bread is the one that you will please. Huh?
Okay,
and so if companies would fund the core development, then maybe the interests of the coin holders are not being represented. Maybe it's better that the coin holders finance core development. What do you think?
Yeah, I think it's a really complex equation that we haven't solved yet. I think that in order to sustain the NXT development, we will need to find some funding. And the folks that are going to provide this funding, rest assured they will ask for something in return. Okay. That's how the world works.
Yes.
Okay. Exactly what would be the formula, I really don't know.
Yes.
There are many considerations in different directions, pressures in different directions. Mm-hmm. I think what we did with the license, with the GPL license, is very good, because what I'm realizing, and in these 2 days I realize it even more, is that many, many people already take NXT and develop on top of it their own blockchains and contribute zero, zilch, nothing back to the community or to anyone. Now, at least now, they are violating the usage license. So if they are successful, we can go after them. Okay, that might be the most profitable business you can get. But of course, it might be profitable for developers or for the foundation, but how would the NXT holders will benefit from us? That needs to be determined. The good news, I think, for the community is that most of the NXT developers, stakeholders, foundation are also large stakeholders of NXT itself. So there are incentives aligned on this to find a way to both fund the development and support the holders of NXT.
Yeah. What kind of funding is required for the core development that you think would be really good?
Okay. Look, I think in the Western world right now, senior web developer costs like 100k a year, right? A senior Java developer like we need for the core maybe costs 50% more.
150k per year, US dollars.
That's how much the Java developers earn in your nearest bank, okay?
Yes.
Or in a software company. Now, I realize that this sounds far-fetched, but the Ethereum developers, the Bitcoin developers, I imagine that's what they are getting right now.
Yes.
I mean, otherwise, it's really difficult to get developers to work on NXT. And we need developers. We need mostly right now on the client, web application, packaging, unit tests, everything. We need good manpower. And right now we cannot offer anything that even remotely compares to what they can get on the open market.
Yes.
It's a big problem.
Oh.
And I don't know how to solve it. I mean, it's a big dilemma of how you take it forward. So luckily for me, I'm not particularly pressed on money, and I'm not going to put 35% of of my holdings. It's not because of me I'm willing to do that, but my wife doesn't let me. So
I understand. Yeah, it's not, it's really good that we talk about this because I think I would like to talk about that more in the future. That's very interesting. I would hope that we found enough developers that have also coins and that are motivated just to work for the value of their coins, but that's not realistic.
Well, one thing I can say is that we have 73 founders. I know a few of them, and I can say that every single one of them is a large contributor to NXT. So everybody talks about the distribution, the bad thing, the 73, the centralization. Think about it the other hand. These 73 people has very high motivation to support NXT. If you have 3,000 founders, each one gets such minute stake that it doesn't really make sense for them to really invest. Okay, but what I see from some of the NXT founders, the ones that I know in person, is that most of them actively support either in development, marketing, pushing behind the scenes. These guys are doing excellent work. Actually, I'm really proud of our 73 core founders.
Okay. Yeah. That's great to hear. It's really good to hear, actually, because for me, I entered only after it went parabolic in price.
Yeah.
So the valuation was already 30 million when I started to invest. And for the past 2 years, I've mostly focused on just investing in the tokens, investing in NXT coins, and making some YouTubes here and there, but I really have to follow the market on the amount of coins that have been sold and bought. And on one hand, I have been disappointed that I have not seen a Bitcoin whale really buying NXT up until today. There have been a few big transactions, but very few. But on the other hand, that also means there has not been like that much selling by the originally stakeholders. At the beginning, the first 2 months, yes. Then about from the 1 billion coins, 400 million coins were like traded. But since then, since after those first 2 months, For about 2 years now, yeah, they have most of them have really, like, some of them sold out, but I have the impression a lot of them also kept a lot of their coins.
I'll tell you, I think that if you look at investment for the short term, you simply can't tell. It's a matter of luck. If you're looking for long-term investment, I like to give you a tip. Okay, every bank out there, every insurance company, every government agency that deals with financials is currently looking into blockchain technology. Mm-hmm. Bitcoin itself is not extensible. People realize it's developing on top of Bitcoin is really, really difficult. So let's put Bitcoin aside. Now look what else you have out there. You have Ethereum. For Ethereum, you need to develop smart contracts. I predict that smart contracts will be very difficult to develop. Smart contracts like the NXT Asset Exchange, I think it's a dream. It's not something someone can develop using the basic tools provided by Ethereum. So people are currently under hype. They will try Ethereum, they will invest a few months in it. Some of them will succeed, some of them will fail. For some application, you'll see it doesn't make any sense. And then they will look for something simple that gives 80% of what Ethereum gives you, that you can use simple JSON, HTTP APIs, that everything is well documented, running stable on mainnet, and I predict eventually they will get to us. The core is in Java. Java is a lingua franca of the business world, okay? More than 30% of the developers, of the programmers today in the corporate world use Java, okay? That's a huge thing. And we have, what do we have in NXT? Java and JavaScript. The rest of the protocols are built in C++. Nobody wants to work in C++. Okay, so we have a good chance if we execute correctly. If we continue to deliver usable, stable product, we have a good chance. Someone will, at some point, understand why they need NXT. Okay?
Yeah, and not an NXT fork, but like the NXT network. Or
I don't know. For some applications, people will have to fork NXT.
Yes.
But we have the GPL license. Either they will open source NXT. Do you think a bank will open source its code because of the GPL license? No. So if not.
Yeah, but my concern there is the money that they would pay, it would go to the copyright holders. Huh? And that's not the coin holders. It's currently a few core devs at an NXT foundation.
I see what you're saying, and I must admit that we haven't cracked this equation, okay? But definitely the idea is that some of these contributions will get back to the NXT investors. I mean, if all applications that will work on the plug on the public blockchain naturally will contribute
yes.
to the, but some organizations, if we like it or not, will use private blockchains. Okay.
Yes.
And we need a way to monetize. And you're right that the core developers can go work for one of these banks.
Yes.
Okay, but I don't think it's a real priority for any of the core developers to go get a day job in a bank. Okay. I think that it's that going forward we will try to find a way to channel possible revenue that we get from the private chain into the public chain.
Okay?
We need to support the NXT Foundation. We need marketing. Before we directly contribute to NXT, we need to finance the day-to-day operation. You know, the guy, the real Bitcoin guy that
I don't know where who is paying for his expenses. You?
Who? Real Bitcoin guy. Oh yeah, yeah. I'm paying him now.
So this is really not sustainable. Okay, we need to find a sustainable way to market NXT. Okay, we need to pay Bass and Bay. We need to pay the core developer. And so we need to figure out a way to do this. First, if we can pay core developers, perhaps we can get more core developers and improve the quality of the UI. We have tons of work on the UI, and you know, perhaps this by itself will be enough. But I think that at some point, I don't know, maybe we can agree that half of the revenue that we get from private blockchains go just to buy NXT on the market.
Yeah.
I really don't know, and it's open to debate.
Yeah.
And it's not. It's just my. It's just an amorphic idea right now. I'm not saying anything, but.
For me as an
investor. But I think as investor in NXT, I think you need to buy what you want. Buy 1,000, buy 10,000, buy 100,000. Set up a folding node. Forget about it. You may not see profit for 2 years, 3 years. But when you will see profit, there is a chance you'll see 100% profit. Okay? So you have to be patient. Nerves of steel. Okay, don't look at the price every day. Every day you look at every 2 minutes you refresh the browser. No, yeah. Invest in it and forget about it. Don't put there your last euro. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
You need to feed your family.
Yes, 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 yes.
In the next 2 years.
So, yes.
So, but think about it as a long-term, high-risk investment. High risk, but high yield.
Yes, yes. So, but do you think that because you have some contacts with these companies? I really have no view on that. How many companies are interested to build on a blockchain? But do you think with the NXT 2.0 proposal that NXT, the public blockchain, NXT then, will profit from some of these companies that wanna fork NXT, but they might not fork it if they have NXT 2.0?
I don't understand. There is some perception that by taking NXT and making it one of the most scalable blockchains around, so by solving the blockchain bloat problem that is so obvious to anyone, I don't see how this should hurt the NXT value or ecosystem. On the other hand, I mean we have huge advantage here, as the other guys didn't even start to think how to do it, if they can even do it. And we have a plan. We have the ability to execute. I cannot commit. Maybe you know we lose hope on the way. I don't know. I hope not. But assuming we can get NXT out stable, it will appeal to a huge market that we do not appeal to right now.
Yeah.
All these guys that want to issue loyalty tokens and sell concert tickets and all these.
So you mentioned, why do these people care? Why can they not use NXT right now, like with these examples that you just gave?
I'll give you an example. In the early days of the monetary system, many people approach me with questions. Okay, I have a concert, I want to issue instead of people paying money for this, I want to give them a token, and I want this token to be scanned at the entrance. Okay, but I told them, okay, but in order to execute a transaction on NXT, you have to pay fees in NXT.
And then they started to think, okay, now I'll take 10,000 people and give each one one NXT so they can execute one transaction on the entry to the... and we started thinking about this. Doesn't make any sense, right? They won't download the blockchain now because they want to go to a console.
Yes.
Okay. So with the sidechain, the good thing about the sidechains is that the fees are paid in the same token as the payment itself. Okay. So now when you give someone a token, just give him enough tokens so he can also transact. Okay. And these transactions, possibly we can allow even on the sidechain to transact without any transaction fees. I mean, if you are a business and you want to run this blockchain, you won't need any transaction fees on your blockchain. All you need is to make sure that your blocks actually are actually included in the FNXT blockchain, and for this you need to pay fees in NXT. But the only one that needs to pay fees in NXT will be the business itself, the business organizer, not the end user. Okay, so this is one thing. Think about pegging to US dollar. Okay, right now we have this asset that tries to peg to US dollar, but then they have the problem that they can only be traded against NXT. So if you want to trade asset and peg it to US dollar, you have to convert to NXT, NXT to peg. And this is very awkward, and you need a plugin, and it doesn't work very well. So people want asset to asset trading. So think about the child chain. That's exactly asset to asset trading. All you need to do as a business is issue a side chain, which is value is pegged to US dollar, to euro, to blockchain, to Bitcoin, to euro, to yuan. Okay. Of course, this is a third-party business. People will have to trust you. But if they trust you, then they can issue the asset on your chain. And not even that, the same assets are going to be global across all the chains, okay? So even the assets that you issued 2 years ago on NXT now will become global and can be traded against Bitcoin, US dollar, euros, using the normal asset exchange. No longer need to create asset-to-asset trading, because you now have sidechain to asset trading. You follow me?
Not fully, but yeah, I mean, that's to be expected.
Okay. But because my understanding is that the asset-to-asset trading requirement is mostly in order to trade. You don't want to trade BG Cafe with give me an asset with a club, with NXT club.
Yes.
Okay. But you do want to trade BG Cafe against RAND, okay?
Yes.
South African RAND. Okay. So now someone will spawn a sidechain that is pegged to the South African RAND. You will trust him because he is a big name in South Africa. And then you can trade the BG Cafe tokens against the sidechain tokens, which is pegged to RAND. And now you have, now the BG Cafe has value not only in NXT, but in its native fiat currency. Okay? So you see how sidechains, after they are live and kicking, can also help on other topics except the blockchain issue. Now it's not going to happen on the first iteration. We'll only move NXT to the sidechain. There will be another one, NXT 2.1, maybe NXT 3.0, where we actually allow you to produce a blockchain.
Ah,
but remember, you have to be patient. This is only the beginning. It will take time.
Yes. Yeah, it will take time before that's released. Like Jean-Luc estimated 1 year. and that's 2.0. 2.1 is maybe a year and a half. But up until now, he has been very good in his estimation.
Exactly. Yeah.
Time.
But you know, 1 year from now, who knows, maybe there will be an asteroid, there will destroy Earth.
Yes, that's true.
But I think we have a good plan, and I think it's possible to execute.
So what other players do you see in the crypto platform market, other than Ethereum, that you think are interesting as competitors from NXT?
I think we have a lot of competition, and there are a lot of great ideas around. The competition will be huge, both from public blockchains. And I don't want to start name calling.
No,
but I have my ideas.
Because I'm into, for example, BitShares. They have their own token.
I have no idea what BitShares are doing.
You didn't check it out.
I checked it out, but I don't understand it. And if I don't understand something, it's difficult for me to invest in something I don't understand.
Yes.
So,
and then you have some newcomers I saw, like Amercoin and Lisk.
I don't even have the time to understand what this guy wants. I think all of these are smart people. I hope they are honest people also, but that remains to be seen. I like, if I must name things, I think the NEM.
NEM, yeah.
I think NEM is something you need to watch.
Yeah?
Yes, I think name is something.
What do you like about them? Because that's a fork of NXT originally.
I think they studied NXT very well. They copied many of the good things in NXT. In some places they improved them. They are a lot behind us in features, feature per feature, but I think they got the core. My impression is that they got it right. That's one chain to watch, and I definitely see it becoming an NXT competitor in the future. I would watch some of the storage solutions. I'm not sure about Mainset because I don't understand what they are doing, but I think storage and I think Saya are definitely points to watch.
Which ones?
Storage.
Is that the name of the coin? Storage?
SJCX. Don't remember the token.
Yeah. And are they traded on counterparty their asset or on Omni? Or do they don't have an asset or they are a coin already?
I don't even know how to buy this thing.
Yeah.
I'm just looking from the technical perspective. I think this solution has a chance because when I put all my data right now on Google or another one on Microsoft, I think, oh my god, and now the NSA will get it. Not the NSA, but the police can get a warrant and get all my data from there. So privacy is a huge problem with the cloud providers. So these guys are solving very real problem that I realize and you realize, but my mother doesn't realize. Okay, but she will realize at some point. So I think these storage solutions, they might see their day, you know, under the flashlight. They might enjoy their time.
In the spotlight.
Yeah. So try to find one that is not overhyped already. and again, it might take ages and the developers may give up before.
Yeah.
I mean, the market, how does Warren say, Warren Buffett. The markets can stay irrational longer than you can stay solvent.
Voila. That's true. Especially if you start buying Lambos. Then your solvency goes time, down quickly.
Next time buy a Mitsubishi.
Yeah, so that's super interesting. So you mentioned before I was curious how you came into the crypto world, and you mentioned that you actually were not involved in crypto and then started researching 2 years ago or so, also during the Bitcoin hype or before already.
Well, I warned these guys, I knew there is a thing like Bitcoin, and it was on the back of my mind. Let's see what it is when I have time, but I never had time. And until, and at some point, I think it was my father, he came to me, did you see this Bitcoin thing? Now it's like $1,000. This is for all you geeks. Why are you not looking there? But, so I'm one of these losers. Yeah. So definitely don't take investment advice from me. And don't put your last money in NXT, please don't.
But you mentioned that you started the researching and you discovered that NXT was Java based, which was something you liked. Huh?
Yes, I think that's why I started with NXT. But when I first looked at the initial code, the code from BCNet, my Java developer looked at this and said, "What is this crap?" But my programmer looked at this and thought, "Wow, this thing is ingenious. I never seen something so deep, such an interesting code in my programming days." And I'm developing Java like since 1998, from Java 1.0, and the ideas behind NXT are so deep and interesting from computer science perspective. Okay, this is something very, very innovative, okay? And it wasn't invented by a big corporation. It was invented by an individual that probably got inspiration from Bitcoin and from 10 other... but what BCNet did is ingenious. And the best thing that BCNet did is that he disappeared and left the work to such a capable programmer like Jean-Luc, that actually took his crappy code and built a real system about it that actually works. So I think the way NXT developed from an idea that that an anonymous programmer developed, and I can clearly tell you that BCNet is not a Java programmer, but I can also tell you he was a genius. Okay.
And so, what did you like in that code that was so genius?
It was the ideas behind the peer-to-peer network, the hallmarks, the ways that nodes validate each other in very intricate and delicate, using very intricate and delicate algorithms with many checks and balances. Because the idea that one node, the peer-to-peer network, where each, usually in peer-to-peer networks, the idea was always that the peers cooperate. They cooperate to download a movie using a torrent. Okay. They cooperate to share data. But the idea that each node does not trust the other node is something that has a lot of implications. It means that every transaction and every block has to be validated and revalidated. Okay. And you have to think in a way that corporate developers do not think about it all. when you are a corporate Java developer and you have a feature to implement, you implement according to the specification. You almost never think about how can people misuse my code? How can people hack it? How can people use it for social engineering? And how can people use it to cheat, to scam other people? But you don't think about these things as corporate developer. Perhaps later someone runs some security scanning, or there is a real, there is a real incident, and you learn from it. But with blockchain technology, you need to think about everything from the beginning, because once it's live, you don't have a second chance. Okay, it's working 24/7, and it's open source, so very smart people look at it all the time, looking for holes. Okay, in a corporate program, it's always closed source, so people have another barrier before they can hack it. Okay. But here everything is naked. You are completely naked. If you fuck up, people will exploit you, and they do it shamefully. Okay, they don't even think that they are doing something wrong. Like when you download a movie from a torrent, you don't really think that you are stealing, right? It's something between the guys, right? So same thing when you hack NXT. The suckers, the amateur developers, didn't think about it. So I exploited it and stole this million NXT. Okay, it's not a crime. It's between the go report it to the police. Let's say.
So
as a blockchain developers, you have to think about a slew of different problems that corporate developers does not bother with. Okay. And it can blow up your mind. Okay.
I have another question. Like, what do you think will be the killer app for NXT, or in what segment do you see that happening? Like with Bitcoin, Bitcoin was just a fun thing to do, but you didn't really need it for anything useful. Unless you value buying alpaca socks in Mexico, eh? That was what the first thing you could buy with it. But
drugs, you could buy drugs.
That was amazing. Yeah, so it was only when the Silk Road started that you could do something with Bitcoin that you couldn't do with US dollars. Eh? Because alpaca socks you could buy with US dollars also. So that was not interesting. A pizza too. And the Silk Road, I think, really gave a lot of value to Bitcoin by being the first really like killer app. And I'm curious, like, do you see that happening for NXT also? Like, decentralized asset exchange is of course something unique, eh? But it hasn't really taken off like the Silk Road has at the time for Bitcoin. So have you put thought into that, what could be like a killer app for NXT? Do you see something in that direction happening, or do you think it's already there, we're just not seeing it? Or do you think NXT 2.0 is a change that will help us get there? Huh?
I must tell you that that I don't know. It can come from many directions. Again, predicting these things. I mean, go back 10 years. Did you think that we can sit here in Holland and immediately broadcast it to YouTube from a phone? It's really difficult. So,
do you think for NXT it will also depend on a black or gray market? Because that seems to be for decentralized crypto platform important, no?
I think that eventually, I know that this area attracts all the bad guys right now, drugs, terrorism, porno, and so on. I think that eventually people realize that blockchain is not a very good infrastructure for these applications. And the reason is that everything you do on the blockchain is public.
And even if you manage to hide your what you're doing now, what you publish on the blockchain is not as safe as your passphrase. It's not as safe as your private key. It's only as safe as your public address. The moment someone identify your activity with your address, which I know that at least on Bitcoin there are tools that can right now identify maybe 99% of the actors, except guys that are really really good at hiding their privacy. So I really, as a bad guy, I really wouldn't bet my future on using these blockchains, because even if today it looks completely safe that your address is there and nobody can identify you, think about a year from now. The good guys can catch you 2 years from now, okay? See, it's not good for your future to know, to be a bad guy on the blockchain.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not good planning for the long run. Not that being a bad guy is usually not a good decision in the long term, but being a bad guy and publishing things on the blockchain, I mean, people at some point will realize it.
Yeah,
it's not going to be the killer app, I think so.
Yeah.
Not anymore. I mean, I know it used to be, but things are too public. They are monitored very easily. And anything you do is going to stay there forever. So
yeah.
It's not in the blockchain itself, in archival nodes.
Yeah.
So do you think it's important to have a cryptocurrency that protects your that would be like much more difficult to track, or do you think that's not important? Than compared to, of course, the bank world, or
I think everything is important, and everything is important. So you ask me who I love more,
okay,
my elder child or my younger child?
Okay, no,
so.
Of course. But what do you think of these other coins like Monero and Dash? Do you think they have a future by trying to offer a cryptocurrency that is much more difficult to track and offers a lot more anonymity?
I think a year ago in one of the Bitcoin meetups, I saw a lecture from Professor Shamir, the S in RSA.
I don't know him.
He's a famous cryptographer. And one of the things I took from his lecture is that he said, trust me guys, I'm 30 years in this business, privacy doesn't sell. Okay? There are very few people that are willing to put big money on privacy. Okay? And somehow I don't see how this is going to change significantly, even though it may change, but I think it was true in the past 30 years and it's true now. It's very difficult to get people to put big money on privacy. So if you only focuses on privacy, I don't think you have you are a good investment opportunity. I think that as a blockchain you have to have some kind of privacy, because you can't wash all your laundry in public. Okay, there are some applications that require privacy, but there is a fine balance. I think that betting only on privacy will not get you the jackpot.
Yeah. So for NXT offering shuffling, what's the goal of this? It's not really to offer anonymity. It's more like to just for other accounts to make it less traceable.
I would say that shuffling. First of all, it's a cool feature. Okay, you have to admit that it's a cool feature, and I think perhaps that's one of the reasons that it's inside. it's a first, it's a very interesting idea. We are the first blockchain that implements it live. And you know, in this world, when there are so many talented people developing software, to be able to say that I did something first, it's a big thing. Okay, regardless how this is going to be used. Now, I think with regards to the level of privacy shuffling provides you, I think that it's good enough against your own aunt seeing how much you paid for a present. It's good enough against your co-worker seeing what your salary is. It's money laundering, so I heard that of that. Against, don't do it, don't use it for crimes and things like that.
Like a nuclear submarine buying that, is that possible?
What?
A nuclear submarine.
What it will do with it? The nuclear submarine?
No, but...
Because eventually, you know, a much simpler way to hack you is to simply find you and put a gun to your head and get your passport.
Yes.
And shuffling won't help you either.
No. So, that's true.
So it's a solution to a very obvious problem. It's cool technology. And I think that did you try shuffling?
No, see the problem I see there is I'm super lazy, I'm an investor, and I'm focused on Lambos. So if I hear that something is not like easy to use, that you have to like for shuffling, you have to do that, you have to keep it open, you have to do it at a certain time, then there is no chance I'm gonna even test it. And I know that's not sweet to the ones created that put so much work in it, but for me it's like, yeah, this is not gonna, that's not gonna, that's just, it's not user friendly enough, and I'm not gonna bother.
How do you know it's not user friendly if you haven't used it?
Well, because you need to keep it open, there need to be an equal amount of...
You need to keep your node open, right?
Yeah, but like you want to mix 100,000 NXT, you need to have someone that also wants to mix 100,000 NXT, I heard.
So what?
Which is, like, you're not sure you're going to have that when you're there Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock at the agreed time. You don't even know if there will be someone to do it with.
Yeah, that's what why we try to do Shuffling Sunday, to make it a social event. I must tell you that when I watched the shuffling go on, I looked at that. That's the coolest technology I've ever seen. I mean, looking at how it works on top of a blockchain, completely decentralized. This is amazing technology. Okay, you can argue that it's not useful now. I agree. Okay.
No, I don't mean useful. I mean not user friendly. That's something different.
No,
useful.
No. Not user friendly. I have to argue. I think we invested many hours in trying to make it as user friendly as possible. We only require you to keep your node open. I think I have a forging node, and I think it's now running straight more than 5 months without a single moment of downtime. So it's not such a huge requirement. And if you, in the remote 1 in a million chance that you fucked up, you'll pay 1,000 NXT, it's $7. So be it, I mean.
but you do need the equivalent. Hey, I want to mix 100,000 NXT. There needs to be someone else that also wants to mix that exact amount, right?
Yes, but you have time. If you need to coordinate with someone, then this is centralization. If you need to post on the forum, we have to make it completely anonymous with zero coordination. Because if you want to use CoinJoin in Bitcoin, you need to go to a Bitcoin mixer. But then you are at the mercy of this Bitcoin mixer.
here, because it's completely decentralized, you are responsible. That's always, decentralized comes with responsibility.
Yeah.
It's like you're responsible for keeping your passphrase safe, and not, you can trust an exchange to keep your NXT, but then it's not decentralized. If it's decentralized, then we move the responsibility to the user. That's always a trade. And I think running a node 24 hours, it's not a big requirement.
Yeah. So is this the first shuffling that is done decentralized without counterparts in this?
Yes, we know the academic team that we are closely working with, the academic team that actually published the shuffling white paper. And we developed the feature according to the white paper and the lead of the development team actually reviewed the shuffling code that we developed. We said, yes, someone else is trying to do it in Bitcoin, but, you know...
But
I'm quite sure this is the first and only implementation of coin shuffling actually running in production.
Yeah.
And doing such complex implementing such complex algorithm in a decentralized system with user interface that is relatively usable. I mean, I've seen shuffling with 30 participants going. Yes, working.
Yeah.
Yes, on the testnet. Yeah.
Oh.
I can give you the transaction ID.
Yeah.
And it works with 30 participants. That's and just watching how this process goes, and to think about all the crypto behind it, all the technology behind it. I think it's a very, for me as a programmer, it's a very big achievement. Even if right now as investor you don't see the real usage of this.
No, for me, of course, shuffling is super useful. Eh? It's just that I'm always thinking about broad market, mass adoption, and I'm thinking from their perspective. And then I see a lot of things that can be improved with Bitcoin, with NXT, but especially a lot of the new features. They miss certain things, which makes it impossible that it's going to be like used by the masses. Eh?
Like what?
Like, for example... the shuffling now, I can only see that working for the massive. When you send a transaction, you can choose to like send it shuffled, and then you click on the button and voila, it's gone, And so the moment you have to like meet up to shuffle, then I think it's just not user friendly enough to be mass adopted.
Okay, so you want your transactions to be shuffled automatically, but.
If you choose to do that,
Dash and Monero knows how to do it.
Sorry?
Who else can do
that? I don't know that. I don't even know if that's possible.
Okay. No, because first requirement for shuffling is that everybody use the same amount, because otherwise we can identify you by the amount of shuffling. So you need to somehow match transactions with the same amount.
But for example, I use blockchain.info to send bitcoins shuffled, and actually it works like that. Then you just say, okay, I want it mixed, and then you send, and then hook. But you do have to leave the wallet open, but then he starts to mix it, and it can take the whole night for it. But it's done immediately after I send. I just have to leave my computer open, and that is more user friendly than having to meet each other late on a Sunday afternoon.
Yeah, maybe what you're saying is that if the shuffling would only specify the minimum number of participants. No, but and then I think one of the problems that you have right now with shuffling is that you don't know when it's gonna start. And then this uncertainty, because then you suspect maybe it will start when my node is down and gonna get penalized. Perhaps we need to make it more predictable that we only ask for minimum number of participants.
I know we discussed it, and the arguments both ways.
Yeah.
Because if you know in advance when it would start, at some point we have maximum number of participants.
The way it works with blockchain.info is that you have to choose how many mixes. So if you take like only one mix, that's gonna be more quickly finished than if you choose 9 mixes, which you could also choose. But the more mixes you choose, the more you need to pay. But yeah, 9 mixes was like the whole night, and it was done too, you know?
I think, okay, so first of all, you realize that you're trusting the third-party service. The blockchain info can take your money and run for days. Okay,
yeah.
You trust them because they are big, and because they have a reputation, but you still trust the third-party. I think that for shuffling, except maybe minor changes, we are not going to invest in it. Right now, probably we have bigger fish to fry.
Of course, and
if it becomes very, very useful, and there will be, low-hanging fruits, we might invest in it in the future. And we are always looking for ideas that will actually make things better. You know, when we released phasing initially, you had to wait until the phasing complete height before it executed, regardless if it was already accepted or not. Later in the next hard fork, now when a phase transaction is already approved by the voting model, it executes immediately. Okay, so we are always working on gradual improvements, and we are always looking for ideas how to these low-hanging fruits, how with small changes we can bring a nice benefit.
Yeah.
I mean, I just like to point out, I'll give you an example of something I developed recently. I've seen that you have now with a client, you almost always log in with your account. Then many times you look at other accounts, you look at the account information. Then I thought, okay, you look at the account information, but this account information does not include everything. It doesn't include voting and shuffling and all. And we don't want to keep up in adding things to this dialogue. So I said, maybe I just add a switch account button there.
Yeah, I saw that.
So now you click switch account and you are in the account.
Yeah,
and then you can
do
whatever you like.
Yeah.
You see, this is something I like.
Yeah.
Small change, big benefit.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, I'm very proud of this idea, and I think it was my idea. But
that's nice. Yeah, okay. I really love that. Every time I update the NXT client, that it's like, hey, this is new. That's really nice.
And if you notice, we now have a back button on this dialogue. Did you notice that?
On what dialogue?
For example, you click account properties, and then check one of the transactions. Then you can click back, and you are back at the account. You don't need to cancel and open again. Check this out.
There
is a back button on the left side of the model. It's documented in the release note, so I thought maybe people will see it, maybe they won't. I think it's one of the most useful features that for me, because many times I check the account balance and then a transaction and then the account balance of the account that sent the transaction and then the block and then another, and then I want to go back to where I was. So now you have back, and then you are back at where you were.
That's really nice. I also want to ask you something about Bitcoin. There's this big problem now about scaling it up.
Okay, yeah.
So they don't want to, there's a big fight going on.
Yeah.
I'm thinking like, actually there might be a future also for NXT there, just for the currency token, since Bitcoin seems to become more and more expensive to do transactions. It seems to be that Bitcoin is evolving towards a high value currency, and that there will be a need for other currency tokens just to do simple payments that are affordable for small payments. And what do you think of that? Is there a future for NXT there or not really, since it's focused on scalability now?
I think that there is nothing that prevents you from using NXT right now for payments instead of Bitcoin, but of course there is a network effect. Go try to market it, I don't know.
Yes.
I think that NXT, I think that our niche would be in more advanced applications. I don't see where we have the edge here.
Yeah.
I mean, there are 600 Bitcoin clones that can do exactly that.
Yeah.
And probably they have enough community behind them. So,
thanks so much for the interview. It was really good. And let's talk again later. Huh? Thanks so much.
All right. Yep.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, Alex.